Chapter 6, Osseous Tissue and Skeletal Structure. So the skeletal system includes bones of the skeleton, cartilage, ligaments, and other connective tissues that stabilize and connect the bones. Functions of the skeletal system include support for our body, storage of minerals and lipids. The main mineral in the skeleton, of course, would be calcium. And the lipids in the form of yellow bone marrow that fills the inside of the bone. Blood cell production. One of the main things people don't realize about bones is that their bones actually produce their blood. Inside the middle of the bone, there is bone marrow that is either yellow or red. Red bone marrow produces blood cells. So this is why when we have cancer of the bones, like leukemia, that actually depletes the blood supply, which is why many cancer patients have to go on blood transfusions in order to stay alive long enough to have chemo. So if the bones are not functioning in blood cell production, then that could be a very, very serious issue. Protection. If you notice that most of our main organs and tissues are enclosed within a cage of bone, like the brain enclosed within the skull, the spinal cord within the vertebral column, the heart and lungs within the rib cage or thoracic cage, and reproductive and urinary organs within the pelvis. So most major organs and tissues are protected by a wall or cage of bone. And finally, leverage. I almost skipped it. Leverage as in that muscles use the bones as levers to move your body. Bone shapes. And these are pretty straightforward. The first type of bone shape we have is a long bone. Long bones include bones like this, like the humerus. And long bones are simply called long, obviously because they are long. And that again includes bones like the humerus, the femur, the ulna, the radius, tibia, fibula, all the major long bones of the body. Short bones include the carpals and tarsals, little short pieces of bone, carpals and tarsals. Flat bone, which of course is called flat because it is very thin and flat. Example would be the bones of the skull, like this parietal bone, or even the sternum, which is the breastplate, or the scapula, which is the shoulder blade. We then have irregular bones, which are called so because they are irregular in shape. These bones have lots of little struts and processes and pieces that protrude off of them, which gives them a very odd or irregular shape. And so an example of an irregular bone would be the vertebrae. We then have sutural bones. Sutural bones are bones that form within a suture. So you can see this is the back of the skull, and there's a suture right there. And this bone has formed within the suture. And finally, the sesamoid bones. Sesamoid bones are bones that form in a place of stress. You may have heard before that there are 206 bones in the human body, but a lot of books will say 206 plus because sometimes people form extra pieces of bone. And sesamoid bones could be an example of some of those extra bones. We are actually not born with kneecaps. Little bitty babies, before they start crawling, they just have really nothing but just squishiness in their knee area. And as they begin to crawl and move around, they start forming a kneecap, which will protect the knee joint. And again, that's called the patella. That's the biggest sesamoid bone in the body. Again, a bone that forms in a place of stress. There are two types of bone. We have compact bone, which is dense, hard, solid bone. This is what's found on the outside of the bones. And spongy bone, which is found on the inside of the bones, and it looks very much like a sponge. Now, spongy bone is not soft like it sounds. It's very hard and rigid as well, but it has a different kind of structure, and we'll talk about the reasons for that as we move forward in the chapter. But in this picture right here, this is a skull bone that has been cut in half, and you can see the outside perimeter of it is solid and thick. That's compact bone, very solid, white, and thick. The inside of the bone looks like a sponge. That's spongy bone. And because it looks very much like a porous household sponge, but those pieces of bone in there are still very hard and rigid. So if you'll look at the board now, we'll talk about the main parts of a bone. Now, I'm going to use the femur as my example, but these rules would apply for all long bones. It doesn't just have to be the femur. Okay? So on the femur, we have some major areas, or on any long bone. The femur is just our example here. On the major parts of long bones, the ends of the bones are called the epiphyses. Epi means on top of, so epiphysis would be the tips of the bone. Okay, so there's one there and one there. Okay, so the epiphyses are the ends of the bone. Okay, and it's written with an ES because that represents plural. You'll also notice in your book sometimes it will be written with an IS or epiphysis. That's just referring to one end of the bone. So when you see an ES, you should know that that is referring to both ends of the bone. We have a middle section. Called the metaphyses. These are the metaphyses. Meta or middle. Okay, there's a middle section. This is the end of the bone. Middle section of bone, and then we're going to label this one last. The metaphysis, the two middle sections between the epiphysis and the shaft of the bone. So in the middle here, we have the diaphysis, which is the shaft of the bone. So diaphysis is the shaft of the bone. Then between the diaphysis and epiphysis, we have the middle section, which is the metaphysis, and then the epiphysis, which are the ends of the bones. So again, epiphysis, metaphysis, diaphysis. Now, if we look at a bone actually cut mid-sagittally, or right down the middle, we'll see inside the bone an area called the marrow cavity, okay? So this is called the marrow cavity. The marrow cavity houses the bone marrow, as you would expect. And the two types of bone marrow we find inside are yellow and red. Yellow is largely made up of lipids or fat. And the red is where blood cells are produced. So marrow cavity filled with marrow. And the surfaces of the bone, the two epiphyses, are covered with a thin membrane of shiny cartilage called the articular cartilage. Okay, so this and this, the articular cartilage. Now, articular or articulation means joint. So articular cartilage is cartilage found within a joint. So what joint would you expect to be here? Okay, where the femur pops in. Hopefully you thought right away of the pelvis. Okay, so this would be the hip joint that would form here, and the joint that would form down here would be the knee. Okay, so we'd add a patella, fibula, and tibia there to make the knee joint. All right, so the articular cartilage is a thin, smooth, shiny cartilage that coats the ends of the bones so that there's no rubbing of bone in the joint. So articular cartilage, joint cartilage. And we'll talk a little bit more about joints and cartilage in chapter 9. So if you'll go back to the PowerPoint. Okay, so in your outline, you'll see those areas that I just labeled for you on the board. Diaphysis, shaft of the bone. Epiphysis, ends of the bone. Metaphysis, that's that middle region where we're going to find a special area called the growth plate. We'll talk about it a little bit later. Articular cartilage covers the surface of the tips of the bone or the epiphyses. Marrow cavity is filled with red or yellow marrow. In this picture is an actual picture of a bone cut mid-sagittally so that we can see the inside and we can see the major areas labeled. So epiphyses are the ends, metaphysis, that middle region, and then the diaphysis, the shaft of the bone. Inside we see the marrow cavity, and of course there's no marrow because this bone is very dried out. But normally it would be filled in with red and yellow marrow in this area. All right, so we're going to talk about bone tissue a little bit more detail. In chapter 4, we mentioned it very lightly, and we talked about that bone tissue is a supporting connective tissue. And when we look at bone, typically, from a macroscopic view, we see that bone is very hard, very rigid, and it kind of looks sort of white or kind of a yellowish white. And if we look a lot closer at bone, if we were able to look at it under a microscope, we would see there's a lot more to it than just a white surface. Osseous tissue is a supporting tissue with a solid matrix. And it contains crystals of hydroxyapatite, and hydroxyapatite is calcium salt. And the minerals of calcium are deposited in what is called lamellae. Lamellae are layers of matrix. An osseous tissue or bone is covered by a periosteum, which is a thin membranous sheath that covers the outside of bone. So what we're going to do now is go to the board and draw out osseous tissue. All right, so if you look in your outline now, you'll see a heading that says cells in bone, and it gives you a list there of some different types of cells and structures. So we're going to be using this list to make our drawings. You can get a visual of what bone actually looks like under a microscope. Now, in chapter 4, when we talked about connective tissue in general, we said that connective tissue must have a set group of things. The first thing connective tissue must have is specialized cells and a matrix. And the matrix consisted of ground substance and fibers. So we're going to pull back from our knowledge of chapter 4. Now, I hope everyone has looked under a microscope at least one time. And if you've looked under a microscope, you know that the field of view is a circle. And everything within that circle of light we can see magnified. So we're going to draw up here that circle that we can see of light under the microscope. So we're going to imagine that this board is our microscopic view, and inside this microscopic view we'll see what bone looks like under the microscope. Okay, so again, the main parts that make up any type of tissue is the matrix and matrix has two parts: ground substance and fibers. Now, we should know that bone, the matrix of bone, is going to be calcium and collagen. Okay, so the matrix, remember, the matrix is what the cells are suspended in. We learned that in chapter 4. So matrix of bone is made up of calcium and collagen. So I'm going to write in, just so we remember, calcium and collagen. Okay, now calcium itself is extremely brittle, but collagen is very, very rubbery. So if our bones were made up entirely of calcium, we would be so incredibly brittle that everything we did, we could potentially break our bones. Collagen is very, very elastic and rubbery. So if our bones were made completely of collagen, we would be like rubber people, and it would be very difficult for us to get around, and our bones would not be very protective of our major organs. So the combination of calcium and collagen together is so strong, it's almost sometimes compared to being as tough as concrete. So bone with a combination of calcium and collagen is extremely tough. The collagen is going to help make the calcium less brittle, and the calcium makes the collagen less rubbery. Okay? So matrix of bone is calcium and collagen. It's about 2/3 calcium and 1/3 collagen. Collagen, remember, is that elasticy stuff that's in your skin, makes it nice and stretchy. It's also what makes up tendon and gristle in meat, and we know how rubbery that feels. So calcium and collagen, and then we're going to have the cells that are suspended in this matrix. Now, before I draw some cells, a lot of people don't think about this or realize it, but bone is highly vascular, very many blood vessels in it. So if we break bone, it will bleed a lot, which is typically why a break comes along with lots of bruising. So at the center of my drawing, I'm going to put in an artery and a vein. Okay, and this is kind of an aerial view, so you're going to be looking down into the artery and vein. Okay, so this area here where the artery and vein are, this is called the central canal. Central canal, where the artery and vein are that are going to nourish the bone. Now, bone is largely made up of a cell called osteocyte. And now I'm kind of referring there to your outline, osteocyte. An osteocyte is a mature bone cell. It's a mature bone cell. It accounts for the majority of bone cells found in bone. They do not divide. They do not divide. And they maintain the protein and mineral content of the matrix. Osteocyte's job is to maintain the protein and mineral content of the matrix. To maintain the protein and mineral content of the matrix. So these osteocytes, I'm going to draw them in, and each little blue circle represents an osteocyte. Now, each osteocyte lives in this matrix, and its full-time job is to maintain the protein and mineral content of the matrix, or to keep the bone nice, strong, and rigid. But each one of these little osteocytes has his own little house, okay, called lacunae, and that word is also on your outline. So I'm using a green circle to represent a little house that the osteocyte lives in. And the word lacunae actually refers to little house. And the definition of lacunae, more technically, is a pocket in the matrix. It's a pocket in the matrix that these little osteocytes live in. A pocket in the matrix. Now, if you are a cell, you're a living cell, all living cells want to have as much oxygen and nutrients as they can to maintain life so that they can continue their jobs. But if you're a living osteocyte cell and you live inside this little house, in some instances you can be pretty far away from the blood supply. So how would These osteocytes receive oxygen and nutrients from the central canal? Well, the answer to that is the other really weird word on your slide there, canaliculi. Canaliculi are little canals or highways in a way that lead from one osteocyte to another. And the actual technical definition of them is a cytoplasmic extension. Cytoplasmic extension of the osteocytes. So they're almost, it's almost like the osteocytes have little tentacles that attach them to each other. And attach them to the central canal. So if each one of these green circles represents a little house for the osteocytes, you could almost imagine that the little canaliculi represent little streets that lead through the neighborhood, one house to another house. So they all can communicate with each other and also communicate with the central canal. So the central canal can send oxygen and nutrients down these little highways and deliver them to the osteocyte. So the osteocytes are always nourished and always in communication with the neighbors. So canaliculi, again, little cytoplasmic extensions of the osteocytes that allow them to connect to each other and to the central canal, their life source. Now, if you look a little closer too, you might notice that these osteocytes seem to form a pattern around the central canal. These rings, and if you can't see them, I'll highlight them in for you in red. Osteocytes form rings. These rings are called lamellae. These are the lamellae, or layers of matrix. Layers of matrix. And I'll fill in a couple of the other labels for you, just in case. This is the osteocyte. This is the lacunae. And this is the canaliculi. Okay, so central canal, osteocytes in lacunae, they're little houses or pockets in the matrix. Canaliculi are the little cytoplasmic extensions or highways that lead between the cells and to the central canal. The lamellae are the layers of matrix or the rings that surround the central canal. And this whole entire unit is an osteon, which is a unit of compact bone. Okay, osteon, a unit of compact bone. So compact or dense bone, which is what we find on the outside of the bone, is made up of these osteons. And there are tons and tons and tons of these osteons, and they grow together to form compact bone. So if you could see the whole surface of a bone microscopically, what it would look like would be something like this. And I'm just going to roughly draw this in without drawing individual cells. But the osteons grow together like this to form the entire bone. So the surface of dense or compact bone would look more like that, covered with osteons. And if you'll go back to the PowerPoint, I'll show you an actual picture of this under a microscope. Okay, in this picture here, we can see a microscopic image, an electron microscope image of the surface of compact bone, or remember compact bone, the outside covering of bone, and we can see several osteons, which is the unit of compact bone. Right here, we have a central canal. There's another one, another one, another one, another one. Central canals, which contain the blood vessels. Surrounding the central canals, we can see lacunae, those little pockets in the matrix. Lacunae filled with osteocytes.
We can see rings of matrix. That's the lamellae going around. Lamellae, lamellae. And each one is called an osteon. And those osteons grow together and form what is dense or compact bone.
So again, it's a unit of dense or compact bone.
I'm going to go back to finish out some of these definitions before we go forward. Osteoblast. This is another type of bone cell. Osteoblast. It's an immature bone cell that participates in what's called osteogenesis. Osteogenesis, if you break that word down, osteo means bone, and genesis is creation, okay? Like the first chapter in the Bible that talks about creation. So osteogenesis is the process of creating new bone or new matrix. So an osteoblast can help us to grow our bones or even to heal one if we have a fracture. Osteoclast, dissolve bone. And you might think, why would I ever want to dissolve my own bones? Well, there are a few instances where that is a very important process, and we'll talk about that a little bit later, so we're going to kind of hold that thought. Osteolysis is the process of dissolving bone. And osteoprogenitor cells, these are stem cells that become osteoblasts. They are very important in bone repair. They are very important in bone repair. Okay, so compact bone is what's located on the outside of bone. Compact bone is located where stress is limited in direction. So compact bone, again, which is on the outside, is actually really great at handling weight. Handling direct pressure from our weight. Spongy bone is what's found on the inside of bone, and it is located where stress is weaker or multi-directional. So spongy bone is going to take stress from multiple directions, so that makes the bone really tough if we combine the ability to take weight with the ability to take stress from multiple directions. Not only do we have spongy bone inside the bone because of it being great at handling stress from multiple directions, but also spongy bone, because it's so porous, will make the bone much lighter. If our bones were compact or solid all the way through, we would be so incredibly heavy that the muscle mass we would have to carry those bones around would be unbelievable. So because of the spongy, lightweight bone on the inside helps make our bones light, but still incredibly tough. So the basic unit of compact bone is an osteon. Osteocytes are arranged around a central canal, and spongy bone contains what's called trabeculi, or trabeculi. So we'll look at a picture so we can compare spongy with compact. So in this picture, which is a great study slide, it gives you all the features of dense bone and spongy bone combined. So here we can see an osteon, okay? We can see the central canal, the osteocytes in lacunae, the canaliculi, all there inside, all the things we talked about, all in the osteon. Here is the spongy bone, and you can see it looks much, much different than the dense bone. It looks very much like a sponge. It's got lots of pores and struts, and that, again, is called trabeculi. Bones are covered by a periosteum, which we've already touched on. That was the covering that surrounds the outside of the bone, a thin membranous sheath. An endosteum is an incomplete lining inside the marrow cavity. Kind of like a periosteum, but on the inside of the bone. So then we have bone development and growth. Ossification is when we convert another tissue into bone. And calcification is when we deposit calcium within a tissue. We're actually going to focus on ossification mainly. We're going to talk about two types of ossification, starting with intramembranous ossification. Intramembranous ossification happens in utero. This is part of fetal and embryonic development. This is the formation of the dermal bones, bones of the skull, and this is going to give you a picture of how that process happens. Now, this picture is found in your book along with the steps below the picture so that you can review this as well in your textbook. So over on the left, what we're looking at here, this is mesenchymal tissue, which we talked about in chapter 4, and that is embryonic tissue. Okay, so again, all this is happening during pregnancy because, as we know, babies are born with their bones intact. So this is the formation of dermal bones like the bones of the skull. And what's happening in this embryonic tissue is we have this embryonic tissue beginning to ossify or turn into bone, which is what this pink area is. This is all bone beginning to form. And this area right here looks kind of like a tentacle. That's called a spicule. This is a spicule of bone. So the spicules spread out into the surrounding embryonic tissue and eventually encircle a blood vessel. Like you can see here, we've got some bone. This pink area is the bone circling a blood vessel, and this will create a central canal, which will eventually develop into possibly osteon or spongy bone tissue. So again, we start out with embryonic mesenchymal tissue. It begins to ossify and send out spicules of bone, which will eventually encircle blood vessels, creating central canals that will eventually form spongy bone and compact bone. So this is how we form the bones of the skull before birth, for example. Endochondral ossification is how you form the rest of the fetus skeleton. We know that when babies are born, they're very, very kind of rubbery and elastic. You can put their little legs behind their head and they don't care. They're just so flexible. But when babies are born, their bones are intact, but they're not completely fused. They're quite a bit soft. The joints are very elastic. And of course, the skull bones have lots of what we call soft spots, where the skull bones have not grown together completely. This allows the process of childbirth to be a little easier on the baby's skull so that the bones can shift as the baby moves through the birth canal. So even though babies are born with all their bones intact, they still have a bit of hardening to do. So endochondral ossification is the production of the rest of the skeleton. And it begins with a hyaline cartilage model. So at first, when the baby's forming, the fetus is forming in the womb, the whole entire skeleton is made up of cartilage. And that cartilage will begin to ossify. And by the time the baby's born, we have the majority of the bone ossified, but we're going to leave some cartilaginous areas. So we'll talk about that now. So in this picture, it shows the steps of ossification of a baby's skeleton in the womb. So starting here, we have a hyaline cartilage model. The cartilage model will then start to have blood vessels growing along the side of it. As the blood vessels move in, this picks up production of bone along the shaft. So we can see some bone starting to form on the shaft of the bone there. The blood vessel will then penetrate into the cartilage and form what's called a primary ossification center. This is where bone production really picks up the pace. The marrow cavity will continue to enlarge and ossify as the blood vessel branches out and grows. We then have capillaries migrate into the epiphyses, forming the secondary ossification centers, which will pick up bone production significantly in the epiphysis. Finally, at step 6, We have the epiphyses filled with spongy bone, and the diaphysis also filled with bone. But there's two areas we're going to leave cartilage at the point of baby's birth. Here we have articular cartilage, which will cushion the joint. And we have a bridge of cartilage here in the metaphysis called the epiphyseal cartilage. That's the growth plate. And we'll talk about the growth plate here in just a second. But let's go through this one more time. So we have a hyaline cartilage model. Blood vessels grow along the side of the bone, bringing in oxygen and nutrients, ensheathing the diaphysis in bone. We then have the blood vessel penetrate into the shaft of the bone, beginning the primary ossification center. Bone production continues, the marrow cavity enlarges, and then we have capillaries growing into the epiphyses, which is the secondary ossification centers. And right before birth, we're left with an ossified bone except for the articular cartilage and the epiphyseal cartilage or growth plate, which we're going to talk about a little bit more now. All right, now if you look at the board, so most of us probably know when we look at an x-ray, what we see in an x-ray is bone. Soft tissue should not really show up very well in an x-ray. We use an MRI for looking at soft tissue like fat and skin and cartilage and things like that. But in an x-ray, we should see the bones brightly shown in white, and then all the soft tissue should be dark or even black. So if we were to look at a child's femur, okay, now I'm going to draw just the bottom part of the femur where the condyles are. If we were to look at a child's femur in an x-ray, what we should see is something like this. We should see the bone show up very brightly, and we should see a black area in the metaphysis. The metaphysis has in it what's called the epiphyseal cartilage. Or known as more commonly as the growth plate. Now when we're born with, as we just saw, our bones are ossified except for the articular cartilage and the epiphyseal cartilage or growth plate. Now the main reason for this is we want to keep this area cartilaginous, because as we go through puberty and through childhood and grow, the cartilage will expand here and then ossify, which will make the bones lengthen. If we were born without a growth plate, we would still be the same height today as we were on the day of our birth, which would certainly not be beneficial. So as long as that growth plate is present, we know that more growing will occur because that cartilage can continue to expand, divide, and then ossify. So this is why if you ever broke a bone as a child or had any type of injury and went in and had an x-ray, the orthopedist may have told you that you still had some time to grow. If he or she could see the growth plate still in place, that's an indication that your growth is not finished. The timing of closure of the growth plate, when the growth plate seals closed or completely ossifies shut, that means that growth has ended. And no matter how much we pray, wish, or hope that we might grow more, we never will when that growth plate disappears. The timing of that closure differs. Some people grow into their late teens, early 20s, and some finish growing in middle school if they shoot up really, really quickly. So it does depend. Now in an adult, when we look at an adult's x-ray of a similar bone, we should see instead no gap. There should be no growth plate. We might see a faint line where the growth plate used to be, and that is called the epiphyseal line. And that's what we all have now, because likely none of us are still growing at this age. Now, if you look back over to the board, we'll look at an example of a child's x-ray compared to an adult's x-ray, and we'll hopefully be able to see some of this. Okay, So in this picture on the left, this is a child's hand, probably a toddler, maybe less, maybe a baby. And what we can see, number one, is notice the carpal or wrist bones are really, really separated. They haven't really fused together yet. This is why baby and toddler wrists feel so squishy, because the bones haven't completely fused. Right here, notice in the radius, see that black line, it's like a crack in the bone? That's the growth plate. We can see another growth plate there. You can see it in the fingers. See the big gaps in the metaphyses? All growth plates. Those bones still have quite a bit of growing to do. So this is a good indication we're looking at a child. This is an adult's hand. Notice, first of all, that the carpal bones are all fused together. We can also see no growth plates. We can see faint lines where the growth plates used to be, but no actual gap anywhere. One other strange thing to note about this is it appears we have an extra bone over here. That's a sesamoid bone. So whoever this is must do a lot of work, manual labor with their hands, and there apparently appears to be some stress on this joint, so there's a little extra piece of bone that's formed right there, another little possibly sesamoid bone or spur hanging off of that joint. Alright, so bone is continually changing through remodeling. Exercise can actually increase your bone mass. And hormone levels like growth hormone and thyroxine can increase your bone mass. Calcitonin and PTH can also control your blood calcium levels. Calcitonin lowers your blood calcium, and PTH, which stands for parathyroid hormone, raises your blood calcium. So we're going to look at how they do that. 99% of the body's calcium is found in the skeleton, and the calcium ion concentration is maintained by your bones, gastrointestinal tract, and your kidneys. Calcitonin and PTH regulate your blood calcium levels. Calcitonin, again, decreases blood calcium, and PTH increases blood calcium. So let's talk about that a little bit more, and we're going to use this figure here. So whenever we think about calcium, we almost always think about how much we have in our skeleton, which is certainly important, but our blood needs a certain level of calcium as well. If our blood calcium is too low, our body will actually take calcium from the bones to compensate for this. So this gives you an idea of how that might happen. So in the middle of this picture here, we can see it says our calcium ion concentration in the blood is below normal. Okay? So if our blood calcium concentration is low, our body releases PTH or parathyroid hormone to raise the blood calcium. And this will happen in three ways. One, the intestine will absorb more calcium instead of letting some of it come out in the waste. The kidneys will retain calcium instead of urinating it out, will keep it. And finally, osteoclasts that we talked about, osteoclasts which dissolve bone, osteoclasts will begin dissolving away at the bone, releasing calcium from the bones and putting it into the blood. Now this picture is a little dramatic. These cells do not take giant chunks right out of the side of your bone. That's not at all what it looks like. But this is just a kind of a vivid example of what actually happens. Those cells will dissolve away at the surface of bone, liberating calcium into the blood. Now what if your calcium ion concentration is too high? If your blood calcium concentration is too high, then three things will happen to help level you out. Calcitonin will be released, which lowers blood calcium. Calcitonin will allow you to urinate out excess calcium. It will allow you to lose more calcium in the waste instead of absorbing it. And finally, it will stop osteoclast action and begin osteoblast action. Osteoblasts will remove calcium from the blood and pack it into the bones for storage. Okay? Remove calcium from the blood and pack it into bones for storage, which overall, those three things will lower blood calcium levels. So what if we break a bone? How do we fix it? Well, it's a three-step process. Fracture hematoma is our first step. That's a large blood clot, a fracture hematoma, and then we form an external and internal callus. So we'll look at a three-step picture of this. So on the left, we can see a broken humerus, and it immediately begins to bleed. Okay? Over a period of hours, a large blood clot develops, or fracture hematoma, to stop the bleeding. Then, an internal callus forms as a network of spongy bone unites the broken ends of bone. An external callus of cartilage and bone stabilizes the outer portion of the bone. The cartilage of the external callus will be replaced by bone, and the internal callus has now reunited the broken ends. We'll be left with an initial swelling on the surface of the bone that marks the location of the fracture. But over time, osteoclasts will chew down that swelling and make the bone look a lot nicer over time. So again, fracture hematoma forms. We then form an external cartilage or an external callus of cartilage and bone, and spongy bone grows together to reunite the broken ends. This remodeling continues until we're left with a swelling marking the area of the fracture. And that swelling will eventually be remodeled by the osteoclast chewing down on that swollen part of bone. Now, of course, if the fracture wasn't bad, there'll be little evidence that the fracture ever happened. But if you shatter the bone beyond recognition, then there probably will always be scarring on that bone and evidence that the fracture occurred. Bone markings are characteristic for each bone and each person, but some of the markings that we all would have similar would be things like elevations and projections, which would include things we learned about in our first lab practical and our second one, like process, protuberance, projections, things like the spinous process or the mental protuberance, depressions, are like valleys, so that would be like a fossa, and a groove and tunnel, an example of that would be a canal or a foramen. Some effects of aging. Osteopenia is inadequate ossification or a reduction in bone mass. It's inadequate ossification or a reduction in bone mass because osteoblast activity declines. Osteoporosis is a loss of spongy bone mass. Over the age of 45, 29% of women will be diagnosed with osteoporosis. That's a very high percentage. 18% of men, 29% of women, 18% of men. The loss of spongy bone mass. And as you can see in this picture here on the left, this is healthy spongy bone under a microscope. This is osteoporotic spongy bone under a microscope. And you can see how brittle and dry this looks. Looks almost like if you blew on it, the bone would just blow away like dust. And it actually can get pretty significantly awful. And you may have heard before of elderly women getting up out of their chairs and just standing up causes the hip to crumble under their weight. Because when it gets this brittle, it doesn't take much to cause fractures in that spongy bone because it's so weak. So again, most common in women over the age of 45, this is certainly an issue, and you definitely want to start having your calcium levels checked by your doctor and possibly consider taking a calcium supplement, especially for women. And that concludes chapter 6.